Sairam, millions of devotees of Bhagwan Sri Sathya Sai Baba across the globe are faced with one reality, that is the physical absence of our beloved Bhagwan amidst us. Of late, before even we are reconciling ourselves to this fact, we are hearing lot of disturbing stories in media, newspapers, on internet. Today, some of our friends came to me and sought some clarifications and explanations. I would like to do to best of my knowledge and to best of my ability. I have received a questionnaire where it contains 15-20 questions pertaining to the current situation and about what is happening. I would like to go one by one and try to answer as much as I could and I can. Should I read out the question?
Yes.
How will you explain your journey with Sai for being fortunate to be born in the Bharadwaja clan? This is something which we feel no words can explain the fortune, or no words can explain the good fortune which God has bestowed on me or on our family. We feel so much privileged, so much blessed that we are brought into His fold, brought into the family in which He is born. We have no words to explain our gratitude for bestowing such blessings on us. It's a greatest privilege for any member who are born in Swami's family to just to know that someone like Sathya Sai Baba is a member of that family and we are part of that wonderful family. But as you all know, Baba, though he is born in a particular family, he has no family bondages. He has left his family at the age of 14. Whole world, be it devotees or non-devotees, all belongs to him. For God, there is no one outside his family. Whoever in this world, all belongs to God, all are children of God. So, from this small family, we have now evolved into, or we have grown into a world family. Whole world is our family, and at the lotus feet, that is what we have gained, that is what we have been blessed. The second question which he asked, when did you first realize that Swami is God? Did your parents tell you this, or Swami himself disclosed this to you? See, I am born into a family which is already a devoted family to Swami. I was born in 1970. By then Swami is already there. He has been recognized by everybody as God. Whoever, all his devotees were already adoring him. So it's naturally has come to me to adore him, to know that he is God. No one needed to tell me anything specially, and just being born in that family itself, it came naturally to me to believe him, to know that he is God. There is a question, it is a rare fortune to be born in Swami's family. Did Swami ever tell you as what kind of good merits in your past lives made you this nephew? Swami did not have to tell me in words. It is the greatest good fortune that any person can ever come across a holy person of Swami's kind. It is the greatest good fortune not only of a family member, for anybody in this world, just to come face to face with a person of stature of Bhagwan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. So it is reiterated in our hearts that just to be Him, to be able to see Him, to be contemporaries with Him, it is the greatest good fortune. The fourth question, during your student days, did Swami show any favoritism to you for being His family? To show any favoritism, you need to have an attachment to your family member, you have to identify with your family. Only then, if you have somebody whom you relate to as a family member, or he is so-and-so, he is my brother, he is my sister, he is my cousin, if that kind of feelings only will create a favoritism or any such kind of feelings in our hearts. But for God, all are children. For God, there is no such place for such feelings. He treated me as a devotee, I felt He is my God. That is all the relationship between us. The fifth question, how were your interactions with Swami? Regarding this question, my answer is, I was interacting with Him like any other student. How any student would interact with Him, like any child will interact with a father, any child will interact with its mother. That's the only type of interaction we had, and it was very, very beautiful interactions, beautiful relationship. No words can describe this kind of a relationship. It's so beautiful. So, sixth question, what was the most memorable miracle that you experienced from Swami? My life has been filled with so many miracles. Just to recall any one at this point of time, is so many miracles have taken place in my life. If a miracle as to what Swami did to me, I would like to share something which so far I have not shared with anybody. On September 25th, 2003, my father had a heart attack. It was in the morning, early in the morning, 4 o'clock, when I have to admit him in the hospital, super specialty hospital. I took him along with my mother and myself went with him and got him admitted into the hospital. And there was no way I could reach him in that early hours of the morning. Next day, when around 8 o'clock, 8:30, when I went to see him and inform him about my father's heart attack, the first words which he said almost confirmed to me that my father is not going to return. He said, "Bangaru, his lungs are tired," which really, for having been with Swami for so long, the way He cryptically gives messages, my heart told me something that is a very, very grave message, very deep message which Swami was giving. Immediately after that, He just patted my back and said, "You must do the best for your father." And He said, "You call any doctor in this world, anywhere, any part of the world, let us get him and get him to be treated." And subsequently He continuously monitored the whole treatment. Whenever we wanted any specialist, including we had flown in some specialists from USA. But all along He knew that the very first sentence which He told me was somewhere deep inside me telling that He has already conveyed what is to come. Then all of a sudden doctor said my father's health was improving and he is likely to get discharged. I thought it's a good news to be conveying to Swami. I went to him and said, "Bhagwan, doctors say that father will be discharged in 2-3 days." Very surprisingly, what he told me on that day, confirmed the very first sentence which he told me the day I informed him about my father's heart attack. He said, "Bangaru, whenever he is discharged, before his discharge from the hospital, just let me know. I need to send him a big vehicle because he has to come lying down." I was quite surprised. All doctors were saying he is going to be discharged. At the most, anybody could say is we will send a car and he can come in the car. But Swami specifically told me he will send a big vehicle because your father is going to come lying down. It is 4 days or 5 days prior to my father's departure from this world. Again, it reconfirmed to me something sort of in my heart. He said, whatever doctor is saying that he is going to be discharged is not going to come true. But I could not have told anybody, nor could share with my family members. But Swami felt that he was making me prepared for something, a grave situation in my life, to face with it and face it with courage. So he was sort of giving me hints and preparing me for the worst that is going to come. Baba knows everything that happens in this world without his permission. I firmly believe, and I have that firm faith, that nothing happens in this world without his will. He is the master. He is the God of gods. He is the one who brings forth everybody and anything into this world, and is the one into which everything rests back. Then, when Swami first had a major hip surgery in the year 2003, how did your family in particular respond? It would have been a bit shocking, isn't it? Definitely, it was a shocking, because we have never seen Swami having any such major any ailment which is requiring any such major medical treatment. Of course, when he had a fall on that particular day, he had not come out till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It was very tense. We were not knowing what was happening inside his room. We took courage around afternoon 3 o'clock. Myself and brother Sri Srinivas went to Swami's room, knocked the door and called out for Swami. Then Satyajit opened the door. We went and saw Swami. Believe me, Swami never showed or never had even showing a little bit of pain on his face. He was smiling. He received us. He said nothing wrong with him. He sat up. He sat on his cot. My father accompanied. And we had a little bit of talking and chatting. And he said he's all right. Then we came out seeing that Swami is all right. Only in the evening, when the X-ray machine was brought, we were shocked to see that the hip was in 3 pieces. I don't know. The way he is disconnected with his body, the way he has nothing to do with it, as if he has nothing to do with his body. He was sitting up. No one in this world with a hip fracture, where hip has become 3 pieces, can sit up and talk to somebody for 15 minutes without giving a hint that he has such a major injury. It's amazing the way Swami has nothing. He's just an onlooker. He's a sakshibhuta. He's just a witness to the whole of universe. That kind of attitude with which he sat up. Of course, what happened subsequently, the doctor said that the hip needs to be replaced. We need to carry him down. We have to put him in ambulance and take him to the hospital. First time ever, Swami is going on an operation table. And naturally, it was a very tense moment. We had never had any such experience ever in the past, it was only one way that anybody and everybody has some problem, go to Swami and seek His blessing and guidance. But here Swami Himself was going on an operation table. Definitely it was very tense moment. It was very difficult time for all of us, not only for family members, for all those devotees across the globe. They were all shocked. They were all sort of taken aback. I think that was some reality check, and Swami had some reason. Whatever Swami does, whatever God does, whatever divinity does, has some reason, and we humbly accept and we should accept whatever He does, because He is the all-knowing and He knows the best. After Swami's confinement Himself to the wheelchair, He slowly seemed to distance Himself from devotees. Was this the divine plan or a decision taken by authorities to give less physical discomfort to Swami? I would like to clarify this very, very categorically. Of course, Swami, as the question was put, that after Himself confining Himself to a wheelchair, can anyone ever confine God to a wheelchair? Definitely this would have been His own will. Definitely this was His plan. I firmly believe this. It is His plan and His decision. Nobody would have. We have seen people coming in wheelchair and walking out of His interview room. We have seen people coming on a stretcher and walking in Prashanthi Nilayam, just by His touch, just by His word, just by His order, just by His instruction. Then why did He choose Himself to be on a wheelchair? That was purely will of Swami, and we should not have any feeling that anybody forced Him or anybody sort of advised Him or sort of coerced Him to do something which He never wanted to do. Nobody could influence Swami's thinking or alter His actions. No. Swami is a... Nobody had that kind of guts. Nobody had. He is Almighty God. Nobody could have ever gone and said, Swami, you do a particular thing or act in a particular way. No. Otherwise, millions of people, can they come and congregate to Swami's feet? It's not possible. If people could guide divinity, I don't think we would have had such a glorious avatar. No. It is He who guided us. It is He who protected us, guarded us, and took us all by hand and led to the path of love, peace, harmony, righteousness, and whatever He has taught us. So there is nothing, and I want to go on record very clearly. Please understand and just apply our minds what He did being in wheelchair. 2003 Swami had a fall, but while He was on wheelchair, Swami constructed one of the very wonderful and one of the largest indoor stadiums in this country. In the shortest span of time, Swami did give water. He did a water project to West Godavari district and the East Godavari district while He was on wheelchair. Swami conducted two huge Atirudra Mahayagnams while He was on wheelchair. Swami conducted from 2003 to 2011, 2010. He conducted every year Gram Seva without fail. He was just on a wheelchair. He was working more than a person who is healthy and who is on 2 feet. How many times He has gone out of the way to please devotees, to attend to the devotees? No, He was doing more work than anybody who is not on a wheelchair. So the wheelchair has never confined Him. His work never stopped. He did all the work, including giving water to Chennai. That work was had started, and He completed while He was in wheelchair. So anybody saying that He is confined to wheelchair and He did not do anything? No. I think that's absolutely wrong perception. He achieved and He did lot of things in last 7-8 years. So this there is the perception that Swami, to me, he performed more than any normal healthy guy who is at half of his age while being in a wheelchair. So his spirit is indomitable, his spirit is the universal spirit. You can never stop that spirit from discharging or doing anything which it wills. There were also some unconfirmed news that, citing Rahu column, Swami's hospitalization was delayed for a few hours. Do you think that was the turning point? No. I must tell you about this Rahu column business. Swami was admitted to hospital on 28th of March, which happens to be Sunday. Tuesday afternoon, the doctors felt that one more procedure relating to heart has to be done. It was around 2:30, the discussions were on. A whole panel of doctors were discussing what is right and what is good for Swami. I was also present. And finally, the doctors arrived at a conclusion and said they should do a procedure called IABP. They need to implant what is called IABP. It was around 2:50. It happens to be Tuesday. That day, the Rahu column happens to be from 3 o'clock to 4:30. One of us brought up this topic of Rahu column also, but it was doctors who told that Swami's preparation for his heart procedure will take nearly 2 hours, because he had already had a pacemaker on 28th, this was on 30th, and as Swami was already in ICU, his parameters, blood parameters, his blood sugars, his blood pressures need to be checked. They have to be sent to laboratories. We need to get back the reports. Then their preparation of the theater and preparation of the people who are going to be in the operation theater, and all extra machines which required, knowing the importance and the gravity that Swami is going to be having a second heart related procedure, they have to prepare every bit of it. We cannot just go in and start a procedure. I think any doctor in this world who knows cardiology or cardiac surgeons will definitely say that this is a basic procedure required for any before any patient is taken into theater. So Swami's blood was drawn by the laboratory people. His sugar levels were checking. His blood pressure was being monitored. He has to be stable. He needed to be stable for him to go under that procedure, undergo that procedure. So there was no delay because Rahu column was cited. It was only noted, but it was doctor's decision and the doctors who said that it takes. In fact, it was around 5 o'clock that we could move him from ICU to the theater. So there was no reason or there was no such occasion where we have intentionally delayed Swami's treatment because it was a Rahu column. It is just simply unfounded and it is not true. Did you speak with Swami before his hospitalization? What did he say? As I said earlier, on 27th only we could see him and talk to him. On 28th we could not speak to him, because we were in a hurry to take him to the hospital. But let me tell you, when he came down to, we were taking him in ambulance, he gave me a very big smile. I was quite surprised. No, he was looking okay. He looked a little bit tired, but he gave me a big smile. Then we all got into here. Swami also was made to sit in the ambulance. Then we accompanied him to the hospital. He did not say anything in particular. Then on that day, the doctors decided that he needed a pacemaker, and they implanted pacemaker on that evening. Did Swami ever disclose about his Mahasamadhi to you or to your family? This has been a burning question for so many people, that did ever Swami say anything? Now if you look back, he has given so many hints at so many times, not related to very near future, maybe past 4 or 5 years he has been telling various people, not only me, various people about that someday or other his body, he will leave his body. He has talked about where he, if as and when he leaves his body, where his wish to be, wish that, you know, where we have right now Mahasamadhi. He has shown that place to, not only he has told me, he has told several people about that Mahasamadhi. This kind of hints he has, time and again he has dropped, has given, but somehow we are all, you know, as children of Swami, we all want him as many years as possible. So we have shut down that kind of thinking. Never we allowed ourselves any doubt that, you know, Swami will ever depart the way he has surprised all of us. Because I am very sure he had no surprise. He had planned, I suppose, when you look back, this is what I feel. During that time I also thought Swami will come, and in a whatever sense that we had, somewhere we used to feel another 10 years will Swami is going to be with us. But Swami had a different calendars in mind, Swami different plan altogether. Perhaps he had no reason why he should have disclosed to us, and we need not have known this, because whatever divine does, that is only known to him. We are, after all, normal mortals. We don't need to know all the details and plans about what a divine does. Then there was a big drama and so many allegations made on Swami's close devotees about his health being neglected. This really hurt devotees' sentiments. Why do you think this has happened? If you look back, let us not talk about or say he was neglected or he was, just when you look back, for me personally, everything falls in place. He had some decision which he had taken, perhaps he had not told us in so many words, but definitely he has done, he has made up his decision, and he knew what he was doing. You see the way he constituted the trust just 1 year back. He was very keen that all of us be trustees along with him. He was guiding us, telling us so many things about the way the trust needs to be running. And to many people, if you see in last 1 year, he has been very kind. He has obliged everybody. Whenever anybody went to him, he just stopped a while and talked to them. He went out of the way to please people, the way he did it. When you look back, yes, perhaps he was just giving all his love to his children, because he knew that he will not be available physically to do that in future. Even on an 85th birthday, I remember initially in the day before, that was on 22nd, he just mentioned that he is not keen to come. But when we prayed, he said, he was very joyous. He said, okay, I will come, I will participate. On 23rd of November when he came down, you know, a little bit of butterflies in stomach, what he is going to say. I was worried. The first question, first thing he asked is, where have you parked the golden chariot? So he has blessed everybody in last He has blessed everybody for last 70 years. He was doing more so like a mother who knew that his children will not get that blessing in future in this form. So he has done that to the maximum which he could. And if you look back, I am very sure he had some plan, he had some decision made, and it was not something abrupt or something somebody neglected. That's all, you know, we are human beings, we tend to attribute things to people, we tend to reason out. But let me tell you, God's actions cannot be analyzed or reasoned by human mind. Let us just pray to Him to give us the strength to accept what it is, and just, He has not gone anywhere. The basic thing we need to realize is that He is with us, He is in our hearts, He is going to be with us ever. God is, there is no way you can say that God is no more. God was, God is, and He ever shall be. Swami is going to be with us, Swami is with us, Swami is in our hearts. For a Purna avatar, Sri Sathya Sai Baba, this kind of a physical departure was never yet dreamt of. Did Swami ever tell you directly or indirectly about this? Perhaps, as a fellow devotee, I would also share such feelings at times. But as we were talking, we cannot analyze the Swami's actions. Our mind is too small, or what do you say? We are too small people to comprehend what a universal phenomenon does. If Swami had gone through this, there must be some reason. All that I feel is, He did not leave us abruptly. He was just slowly leaving us by getting Himself admitted to the hospital, whatever the 25 days, 28 days, whatever ensued after that, sort of prepared everybody for what the decision is already made up. If He had done it abruptly, saying, I am leaving this body tomorrow, perhaps many of us would have not been the same, or many of us would have really don't know what we would have done. He sort of prepared everybody, and especially personally to me, whatever He does, whatever He has done, is not without a reason. There is always a reason for all of His actions. Every word He spoke had some meaning. He never uttered any word which is for sake of talking. Every word had meaning, every action had a meaning. I am sure, perhaps now we are in sort of a period of shock. Definitely what He has done will be revealed to us maybe down the lane, maybe 2 years, 3 years down the lane. Definitely we will come to know and why He has done, and He Himself will reveal to us in some form or other. We have to patiently wait and just wait for Him to reveal that to us, instead of drawing any conclusions. Our avatar, we have not seen any avatar leaving a physical body in this, from this world. How many avatars have we come across? This is the first time ever in human history we are coming face to face with God. There are gurus, there are any number of elevated souls, but a person of Swami's stature, Bhagavan's stature, can you show me a guru or anybody in this world who claims themselves to be master, has so much done, so much been part of the world, and still retained his divine pristine purity? No. The moment anybody, that's why our rishis went to forest, our elevated, our so-called gurus secluded themselves, they went to forest, they went to Himalayas, they went to secluded places and been with them, because the moment they come to the world, the vasana of the world, vasanas of the world will definitely sort of having effect on them. So they always went away. But Swami came to us, been with us, been like any one of us, and taught us how, and showed us what divine is. And he always, God, whether he's in amongst the devotees, whether he's in dining hall, whether he's in bedroom, the pristine, pure God that he is and he was and he shall be. So I am very sure this kind of argument that a divinity or an avatar of Swami's stature to go through hospital, I don't think we should. For him this was also a physical body. It is not Swami who was in a hospital, it is his physical body. As I said when he is, in the same interview, when we went to see him when he had a hip fracture, he was as if he was not part of this body. And how many times in his discourses he has told us that he is not his, that the care of this body is left to his devotees. And this body doesn't belong to him, this body belongs to devotees. When the time came to leave his body, in whichever manner he chose to be, I think that is not for us to question. And whatever, perhaps even residual sort of doubts we have, let us have some patience. Swami will clarify them, I am very sure about it. Even though it means nothing to Sai devotees, but the outside world was astonished to know about the money and gold found in Ajur Mandir. Why did Swami keep this much of wealth with him? I am sure there are few others who knew about this. Could you tell us about this? A lot of people have this kind of one doubt or one kind of question which is ever coming in their minds. On June 16th, when all the trustees, in the presence of some independent outside third party witnesses who are happens to be very respected people, like former judge from Supreme Court, former judge from High Court, when we opened, we found, and whenever we took the inventory, on that day when we took the inventory, whatever was there, we accounted for and we gave and we made known to the world through media, to the, all the devotees, that there was 11 crore 56 lakhs cash, 98 kgs of gold and 307 kgs of silver. Now there are so many people who having doubts why Swami kept so much money in cash, so much of gold. And many people, media persons asked me about this, that you say that trust never deals in cash, we only transact in check and DDs. Why was so much cash found in his chambers? Let me say whatever I felt, what it was. Sathya Sai Baba has millions of devotees across the globe. Whether this cash or gold is offered by devotees to him. Here one distinction which we need to note. All these offerings or whatever deposit, whatever we found, are not received by Swami in the capacity of a trustee of a charitable institution. It is an offering of devotee to a God. He is God to millions of devotees. Even the devotees are offering to their God. I think we should not find anything wrong in that. He had not received any of them in the capacity of a trustee of a charitable institution from a donor. No. These are all devotees who have given him. We have seen Swami collecting letters in the darshan line. Many people keep any object or keep some money in it and they hand it over to him. Let me tell you, when we opened it, nearly 90% of these covers were unopened. Swami had nothing to do with the money. He is above all this money, gold. No. Swami had never had any attachment to them. It was just the offerings of devotees to their God. And let me also tell you, he is being so loving God, he never wanted to disappoint his devotees who are making such offering. When we saw that so many covers are unopened, I saw a currency, a small pouch, which was not opened for 10-12 years. So there was no, you know, people thinking that there was so much cash received by a trust. No, this is not in the capacity of a trustee. This was, these were offered by devotees to their God. So let us not have a confusion, let us not have any conflict in our minds about the whatever so-called wealth found in Swami's institution. In any case, our institution is so big, what we found is absolutely very, very small amount, and for which, as and when we found that, as a law-abiding institution, as we have great respect for every statute in this country, laid down by law, laid down by government, we have immediately transferred 30% of money as a tax towards what we found. We found maybe around 30 crores or 31 crores, whatever calculation. We added up and we said, let us pay, this is 30% of tax, and we have transferred 10 crores to the income tax department as tax. So we have been very transparent. Though we have received this as an offering, I firmly believe this has just been an offering of devotees to their God. Please don't read this as a trustee receiving cash from donors. No, it is not so. Swami is just not a trustee of a public charitable trust. No, Swami has made me, Swami made another four people trustees of a public charitable trust. But we don't have that stature. He is God. He is God for all his devotees. And devotees had every right to be, give anything which they liked to their God, offer to their God. So let us not have any distinction, or let us make very clear distinction of this fact. Let us not have any doubt that some cash was stashed away or so much gold was kept. No. Most of it was not for Swami. We have seen how simple the Swami was. His living style. He is the most simple person you can ever come across. So please don't have any apprehension or any doubts about what we have declared. Whatever was there was devotees' money. So we have declared and deposited the money into the trust account, which happens to be again devotees' money. We have also deposited all the whatever we found gold in the safe lockers in State Bank of India. What is to be done? How do we deal with it? Just wait. Let us go one by one. Maybe in future, maybe the disposable portion will be disposed and the money will be credited to the trust and used for all the good works. Definitely. If there is anything which we need to preserve for posterity, preserve for as a memorabilia, definitely we will do that also and place them in a museum for people to see. No, it's so many assorted things. 98 kgs of gold consists of so many things. It is not any statues which people are making out to be. There are no very big statues there. There are many, many articles which people have presented, like somebody a tumbler to Swami in gold. Somebody we have seen in 70th birthday in Hillview Stadium. People came and gave gold articles to Swami on stage. All those things are there which we have taken account of and we have deposited in the bank. It was told to him, definitely, yes, with his permission, yes. We prayed to him that there is a procedure. He said whatever doctors need to do, let them do it, yes. even today he converses with me.
On a physical level.
So perhaps maybe a week, I can say a week, 10 days. No, we did ask him a couple of occasions, and it was just his love for his devotees which made him. It's an expression of an emotion. It was not crying as such. It's just an expression of his love, or the deep love which he had, and he was expressing it. He very clearly said it is nothing. He is not crying. He said it is the deep love which he has for his devotees, which made this expression of love, because it was a deep emotion, so that was getting reflected on physical body. See, a lot of people even have sort of doubts about somebody from my family going and requesting Swami or pressuring Swami to make me trustee. It's all very, very unfounded and untrue. Let me tell you, there is a kind of a norm which they had kept for themselves, that a person, unless he is 40, cannot be a trustee. That is a kind of norm which their trust has kept for itself. So when my father died in 2003, I was only 33. It is not that I was every time asking. For last 7 years I was fighting for this post, and I became a trustee. I needed to wait till I became 40, and Swami asked me, how old are you? When I said 40, that is the time when he was constituting trust. So there was no question of anybody pressurizing Swami or anybody asking a post. How could we ever go and say, make us a trustee, or give us this post, or make us this? No. These are all incidental to our being at the lotus feet. All these positions or posts which are given are only incidental to our being at his lotus feet. It is not. Also, let me clarify, all these posts or whatever positions people are thinking, they are meant for service. They are not positions of influence. We don't start wielding our influence and trying to do all sort of things. The trustee is a first servant in Prashanti Nilayam. Let us be very, very clear on this. Swami's mission, if somebody is at the helm of affairs or somebody on the top, they will be, or they should be, the first servants of the mission. So it is just that I was not 40, and when Swami was reconstituting the trust, I had turned 40, so all this coincided. So it was not that somebody pressurized Swami or somebody requested, no. And Swami perhaps had his plan, and it is purely his decision. And he had mentioned to me a couple of times earlier that he would like me to come and take an active part in future to come. Yes. Definitely, younger people are going to come into the organization, into the trust, definitely. It is written on the wall. We don't need to sort of debate on that. Students and Swami has got so many devotees across the globe who are doing so well, who have been in very good positions, who would like to dedicate themselves. We have ever so many people. Definitely, we will take the help and we will take them as a part of our organization, our trust. Students are already part of it, and the students have a very major role to play. Yes, no doubt about it. See, there's so much made out on this 35 lakh rupees which is seized by police, and unfortunately we are convicted before even trial started. People have drawn conclusions that we have done something wrong. We had malafide intentions. The incident happened this way. That some devotees who wanted to contribute this money approached me and said, "This is the money which we have brought for to be used for Mahasamadhi construction." I asked them whether it is an accounted money, whether it is. They said, "Yes, it is an accounted money." Then, in the form of cash, we cannot receive in the trust. Trust only deals in checks and DDs, but. We had decided already that trust is not going to construct Mahasamadhi. So, with the devotees' contributions and devotees who would like to contribute could do it. So, when they had such a strong desire to contribute, I said, "Okay, I will tell contractor and you can pay to the contractor, because there is a marble which has been purchased from Rajasthan and." All this was marble was costing almost 25 lakhs and so many related works. So I said, "Why don't you pay to the contractor so that he can use this for works in construction of Mahasamadhi?" They said, "Just place it at the lotus feet of Swami and hand it over to the contractor." It is such a simple thing which we never thought will be blown out of proportion. We carried it in, just brought it out and gave it to the contractor. This is recorded. When I took this money inside in a carton box, it is recorded in police records. Perhaps even a CCTV would have it, visuals have it. We brought it out in the car and we gave it to the and let me tell you, when from Ajur Mandir, after placing at the Swami's chair, when we are loading it in the car, there were 8 to 10 policemen around the car. So, if we had any malafide intentions and we wanted to do something wrong, we would have not done such an act before so many people. It was a very normal affair. We never had any intention of wrongdoing. We were very much aware it was being paid to the Mahasamadhi. Our conscience is very, very clear. That's why. We are not very much perturbed about what people are saying. There is a malicious camp, maligning campaign is going on our institutions, on Swami's name. People who don't like Satyasai mission flourishing, people are saying all sort of wrong things and untrue things. It is not true. It is just some vested interests, some people who are jealous, some people who feel threatened, or I don't know, some people may be doing for heck of it. So all of them got together and mounted this kind of very vicious attack and campaign, so that people, devotees, are confused at this point of time when Swami physically not with us, they felt it's an opportune time for them to come in and try and disturb the peace of people, the peace of devotees. So I am very sure, with the power of God, who is our Swami, all these things will fade away. This is one more passing cloud, as Swami used to put it. I can only say we are grown stronger, and our resolve is much more firmer to carry on his mission. In spite of so many channels, so many news agencies, so many stories going about us in internet, we are still in one piece. That is the miracle of Swami. So regarding will of Swami, there are so many times we have explained and clarified this position. As far as Swami's will is concerned, we must understand that he did not have any personal income. He did not have any asset which generates income. He was not doing any business. So he did not have any bank account. So there is no question of him writing a will for any of his assets which does not belong to him. All what we see in the Prashant Nilayam or elsewhere belong to Satya Sai Central Trust. Satya Sai Central Trust is a legal entity, a different body altogether, having its own legal constitution. So an individual writing a will for a legal body, a registered body, does not arise. So legal position is that, and in actuality also we did not find any will. We have not found any will in all our searches so far. It is perhaps some people are trying to create confusion by saying all sort of things, and regarding some overseas devotees saying about Swami's instructions, maybe whatever such instructions were there he can share with us. And whatever possible, we can, if we can implement them. But when Swami gave such instructions, under what circumstances, and what were the instructions, and why was these instructions held back for so long? We need to have more clarity on this. Right now, no. All that we want to concentrate is to maintain what Swami has done. We don't want to try or do something. Swami was God, he could foresee anything, and he said something and it got fulfilled. We are normal human beings. We have to be realistic. We have to know what is our position, actual position, be it in the trust or whether our position, how it is in financially. We have to take all that into account. If Swami said a project and announced a project, he could inspire millions of people sitting here to donate money. But we are normal beings. We can't venture into such kind of projects which Swami had done it. But definitely our service activities will be there in the line of Swami's teachings. And our focus and our aim is to just to maintain what Swami has given us, hospital, Swami has given us university. So he has shown us Grama Sevas, he has given us mobile hospitals. We have enough on hand, and all that we need is to maintain them properly, maintain them in the way Swami would have her, he was maintaining her, he was doing his work through their, those mediums, that is giving service to poor and needy. So if we can maintain them and serve the poor and needy, I think we would have done a great service to Swami's mission. We would have been true devotees and our life will definitely find fulfillment. No, we have no idea about Prema Sai, and as and when Swami decides to bless the mankind again, he himself has to come and declare who he is. It may be 20 years or 30 years down the lane. So let's wait for such a time, and whoever is around then, let them have the benefit. He has been in Shirdi, so devotees of Shirdi still keep going to Shirdi. Swami's mission in Parthi is the mission, whatever he has done here, this will continue. Prema Sahib, if as and when Swami decides to come, he will come and he will continue his work as a Prema Sahib. It won't be mixed up from here and there. And Swami has never told, at least I have not heard him saying anything specifically on Prema Sahib. Just a rumor, a lot of wild rumors are there, and I am very sure there are so many people will start coming out saying they are also Prema Sahis and Vivekanandas. So I think people do take advantage of this situation. I think we may come across many Prema Sahis, many Vivekanandas like this. I think we should just wait, and the actual one will reveal itself. Don't worry, we need to. So, you see, when sun rises, you don't need to be told that there is a sunrise. It is self-effulgent. When Swami comes down, all of us will know. Our hearts will be filled with joy. We don't need to have any confirmation from any third party. We ourselves will know it. Thank you, Sai Ram.